Hello everyone. In this video, I want to talk about how you can make your own weather effects in Godot. And in this video, I want to specifically address the weather effect of rain. So that is what I want to show you. And for that, let's just start up the game. As you can see here, there are a lot of raindrops falling on the ground, and once those raindrops hit the ground, they have a little bit of an animation applied to them in order to make this splashing on the ground more interesting to look at. Now, there are many different ways you could make such a weather effect possible, and it very much depends on how much of the weather effect should be in the visual aspect of the game, and how much of it should be physically correct in your game. So, if you have mostly an indoor scene where you might have some kind of window looking outside and it should be raining, but aside from that you can't access that outside area, then this method that I provide you with today is probably not the one you want. As my method is very resource intensive in terms of CPU cycles and processing in general. So if you have something like an outside area where you can walk through and want to have more or less believable rain in terms of it falls on the ground, it does something there, like splashing, and it reacts to the environment depending on whether it is hitting a ground or maybe a statue or something else, then the method I'm providing you with today should be something that you might want to look at. And it might be a little bit confusing right now, but I think you'll get it once I get into the code itself, which I want to show you right now. So the first important thing is I have this specialized scene here called Raindrop, and it consists of a kinematic body, a collision shape, and a sprite 3D. I applied to the sprite 3D texture, and this texture has multiple frames in it, the normal raindrop frame and also the animation for when it is splashing on the ground. I have all this in the same texture because that way I need for all my raindrops only one texture, and I don't need to switch this texture at any point. So that is something that really saves processing time. So I would recommend you do that too. Okay, aside from that, there are these this animation sub-tab in here, where you have to define how many vertical frames and horizontal frames you have. So in my case, I have these 5 frames here in the horizontal direction, so I put the number in here, and in here I can define which is the current frame to be displayed. That will be important later on, once we get to the actual animation part of it. Now you might be wondering, if I'm using some kind of animation, why I'm not using something like this animation player here. The reason for that is because we have so many raindrops, we want to make the singular raindrop object as small as possible in terms of how much processing is needed for it. And in our case, we don't need a complex animation system. We just need some way to display frames sequentially with each frame so that they change over time. And that is something that Sprite3D already can do. So we don't need an animation player or anything of that sort. We program our animation system, if you want to call it that, because it's a very, very stripped down version of the actual animation system of Godot. We program that ourselves later on. Okay. So that's everything for Raindrop. Now there is this Raindrop script that we need to talk about, which is gets attached to Raindrop, obviously. And this script works in conjunction with the weather script, which is more of a parent script for the raindrops in order to manage them. And this ground script. Now let's just talk about what weather and ground actually are. So weather is just a spatial node that has obviously the weather script applied to it. And this is just a way to organize those different raindrops that we have in the game so that you can access them in here via this particles variable. The weather script basically instantiates all the raindrops that have to be displayed. And then later on, those raindrops have a certain behavior applied to them that they can mostly work on their own. But what about this ground script here? Well, because we are using collision detection for our raindrops in order to figure out when a drop is actually hitting something so it should play its splash animation, we need some kind of collision object that can actually interact with raindrops. And that is what ground is for. So if you go into 3D world, you can see, let me just look it up where it exactly is. Let's go in the 3D view. Oh no, wait, I know where it is, huh? It's not in 3D world, it's in building. And there you have it. So this is a collision shape applied to the area, to the node area or area node ground. That's the name I gave it. And this has the ground script applied to it. And you will also see that I have collision shapes applied to the roof. And the roof itself also should have the ground object. It doesn't have right now. But we can assign it to the roof. And those collision shapes on the roof can act the same way as the ground floor. So in case a raindrop hits this roof, it will also play its animation. So even though the script is called ground, it can be used for many different things. You could also apply it to the to this decorative statue, I would call it right now. Not sure what the proper term for that is in English. And yeah, you can apply it to everything you want that you want to be affected by raindrops, or rather you want the raindrop to be affected by that object. So in those cases you would apply this ground script to the according area that you put around your object of interest. Okay, so with that we can now go into the scripts and take a look. Now this ground script is the easiest one of all. We have this constant here called raindrop name, and this is important in order for us to figure out what kind of object got inside the collision area. So the thing is that all of our raindrops have the name raindrop applied to them as their node name, as you'll see later. And by doing so, we can go into the process function of ground, get our overlapping bodies, so all the kinematic bodies that are currently interacting with this ground area. And for each body, we check what the name of that body is. And if it is a raindrop, so it has the raindrop name, then the body is on ground variable is set to true. And is on ground is obviously a special value that we use in our raindrop script. So that is one thing. Now next, let's talk about the weather script, because it's also fairly easy. We have these export variables here that are there for figuring out how many instances we want of our raindrops and how dense basically they should be spawned, how large the area is that they should be spawned in. So this constant raindrop here is our preloaded raindrop scene that I already showed you, this one. And our variable particles is an array in which we save all of our raindrops that we instantiate. Now on the ready function of the weather script, we first have to randomize our random number generator of Godot. By doing so, we make it so that on each time we run the game, the randomized or the random values that we get afterwards will actually be random. A different seed will be used. So the function for calculating random values will have a different input parameter and therefore have different random values to put out each time that we are calling that. Otherwise, you would see something like on each startup, each time you start up the game, the raindrops would spawn in the same location. And while the player might not notice it, it is something that you should still take into consideration or rather prevent. And yeah, you can do it by just calling randomize, so it's very easy to do. Okay, after we've done this randomization, we instantiate all of our raindrops by just calling for e in range 0 to number instances, which is our export variable here. And then we first get random values for our x and z position. For that we use the random range function between minus our x scale value and our x scale value, both halved, So that where, let's take 40 for example. In this case, we would get a value between minus 20 and plus 20. So something around this. The same for Z. And afterwards, we can call this in order to get a unique raindrop. And this is really important. We want a unique raindrop. So a raindrop that doesn't share certain information with other raindrops. And for that, we have first to call duplicate with a parameter true, so that it will be unique. And afterward, we can use the instance method in order to actually instantiate the raindrop. Then we set the name of a node to raindrop, so that it can be detected by the ground script, and add the drop as a child to our weather object that has the weather script applied to it. Then we assign the value for our raindrops, for the position of our raindrops. We have already calculated x and z, but we should also calculate the y position. And the y position in this case is random range between the 0, which in my case is the ground level, and translation.y, which is the position of our weather object itself. Now, why did I choose to do it this way? Well, for one thing, I want to be able to say where the particles are falling based on where the actual weather object is. I want there to be a dependency. And I decided to do a random range here, because when you start up a game, you don't want all of your particles to start at the same y position, because then they would all fall down at the same time and it wouldn't be rain. You know, it would look weird because they would all fall in probably the same speed and with the same, with no distance to each other in terms of the y coordinate. And that's not how rain works. And therefore, we have this random range applied in here, so that there actually is always a little bit of a distance in terms of y position for the different raindrops. Now, also, we also apply to the raindrops the x scale and z scale, because it will be important later on when we want to reset the raindrops, and also the y start. Now, in that case, our y start is translation y, because we already made the distance in the y position. Therefore, the different drops will fall on the ground at different times, so they can start right up at the same level of the weather object. We don't need to randomize it anymore, because if we would randomize them afterwards, then they would just spawn in the middle of the screen, and we don't want that. We want them to spawn outside the screen and fall down on their second pass, basically. The next thing is motion, which has also a random range applied to it in order to vary the speed of the different drops to make it a little bit, or make it seem a little bit more random in terms of how the rain falls down, basically. We assign timer as a zero value This will be important for our animation. So we start out with value 0. And afterwards we can append to our particles array our drop that we have instantiated in this for loop. And we do that again for all the instances of raindrops that we have. So this is why this method that I'm showing you here, this algorithm, is hardware intensive, because we need a lot of raindrops in order to believably simulate a decent looking rainfall. And each drop has collision shapes applied to it. So there are already complicated objects in terms of that they need a separate scene in order to define them properly. And while I made sure that they are as small as I think is reasonable, they still need a lot of processing power. So keep in mind, you can't just go ahead and put a gigantic value in there, because then you would have frames, your game would run in one digit frames, so frames per second, that is. And obviously no one wants to play that, so keep that in mind. And in case you really need more raindrops, then you would have to do further optimization on this algorithm or on this method, on the scripts, and on the objects that you are using. Okay, so with that we have talked about what weather does and what ground does. Let's take a look at the last piece of a puzzle, that is the raindrop script. Now you've already seen how those variables are being assigned. And in this script we have two functions. One is the physics process function, and the other one is the animate function. And the animate function is just there in order to play the animation that we have for our raindrop once it hits the ground. So I will talk about that first. We have our timer function, our timer variable, and we increase that by delta, which is the delta from physics process that gets passed. And depending on what value, what timer has as a value, then a different frame is being displayed of Sprite 3D. In my case, I decided that I would say that the timer has a value between 0 and 1. So because I have basically 5 frames to display, counting the fall frame also, then I needed to have this condition block in here in order to properly assign them. There are different ways you can do that, of course, but that very much depends on what kind of animation you want to have in your own game, so feel free to change that if you want to. Okay, then we can go to the physics process function. And the first thing you see here is this global, is this condition, global transform origin dot y smaller than 0. And this is a precaution in the case that a raindrop for some reason might not fall on this ground. It might fall outside of the area, like here or something. that in itself isn't a bad thing, but because we want to reuse those raindrops, we need to make sure that at some point they are triggered to be on the ground, even if they are outside of the area. Because only then we can reuse them, reassign a position to them, and let them fall down again. So that is why we have this condition in here, and set is on ground to true inside the raindrop script. Now, in case that is on ground is true, one thing we have to do is to rotate our sprite in order for the animation to be believable. Because so far, you will see the raindrop basically from the side. You look through the camera and the raindrop will fall from top to bottom, always. But the animation itself is being played while the drop splashes on the ground, so it is not in the same alignment as the falling rain. Instead, it is not in the view of the camera that you can basically look straight onto the sprite, but instead it is laying on the ground. So only if you are able to see the ground, you are also be able to see the animation being played. And in order to have that, we need to rotate the sprite so that it is actually laying on the ground in terms of its rotation. After that, we animate our animation, obviously. I already talked about that. And in the case that timer is greater than 1, we can reset our raindrop. And the reset looks like this. We assign again a random range to our X and Z position and assign those to the actual translation variable for our object that defines the actual position in 3D space. And we assign Y start to our translation.y, as I've mentioned earlier, because we want to start the raindrop at the very top again. We reset our frames to be 0, so that we can use the very first frame here again, the falling raindrop. And obviously, then we also need to revert our rotation back so that rotation degrees x equals 0. Our timer needs to be reset also. And because we want to randomize the raindrops, we can also change the motion again to have a random range between 2 and 4, for example. And obviously, we need to say that it's not on the ground anymore, because obviously the raindrop is somewhere in the sky. If the raindrop is not on the ground, then we want it to fall down. So what we need to do there is call the move and collide with delta times motion, as we have defined the motion already here, and redefine it once we reset the raindrop, etc. So that is all that we need to do in order to make the rain fall down from its initial position onto the ground. And there you have it. That is how you can implement your own rain effect in your game. And again, this is not the only solution. Depending on what kind of rain you actually want in your game, you can go for different solutions that may or may not be less hardware intensive. But that is for you to decide, because it's, after all, your game. With that, I want to thank you very much for watching, And until next time, bye bye.